Please, go ahead.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm from DEV. This is a brief introduction to DEV, where we deal with the projects of avionics and AW. And in avionics, we are taking a quantum jump to the IMA kind of an architecture for various programs. And in EW, we are getting into the digital receiver concepts. And basically, I am here to give applications, to brief on the applications, basically on EO and IR programs which we are dealing in there. And these are the major programs which we are dealing in there. That is the sense and avoid system for UAV, then precision and dynamic targeting for UAV, infrared search and track system, missile warning system. Yeah. This program, Sense and Avoid, is one of the program which we took it for an UAV, which is in a combat class of an aircraft. Initially, the CN avoid capability came for a manned aircraft for the safety where the mid-air collisions could be avoided. The similar feature was looked for an unmanned aircraft where it could fly in the national airspace and share the space with the other aircrafts. An equivalent level of safety or better safety need to be achieved. That was the major program here. And what is the solution for this? This being an unmanned aircraft, it's by the sensors which you have to achieve the safety measures. So we looked into the technology and worked on that sensor data fusion, where we looked onto the different kinds of sensors that could be used. One is the TCAS, ADS-B and EO-IR. They all are of different nature. The TCAS is of the, it's a secondary surveillance radar, and it's what parameter is sensors is basically the range, bearing and altitude, and but it's an integrated effort. You have to query and get the information. And ADS-B is basically, it's a broadcast concept. Every aircraft which is equipped with this sensor, it will broadcast its information in terms of position, and it's better in accuracy because the information is derived from the GPS and the altimeter. And we looked into the UOIR concepts of this, so how to utilize this. This is basically from UOIR sensor, you can get azimuth elevation information, and it's better than these TCAS and ADS-B in one way because of the high update rates what you get it, and it's a passive sensor, and what angular measurements you get is much more accurate than the radar systems. So that was the basic workout here. And the sensor avoid, the specification which we looked into was like one of the major concept is the 500 feet miss distance. Any conflict traffic which should not have a less than 500 feet. Because the process goes like this, you have to detect, you have to track, take a collision alert, take the decisions to turn and start turning to avoid the collision. So there is a definition for all these things. And the field of regard is chosen, it's in the frontal hemisphere, and basically the elevation was, the field of view for the elevation is plus or minus 15 degree. This is because of the vertical separation space that need to be provided. And it has to, and one of the advantages of you mixing the sensors is the availability of parameters under adverse weather conditions, and you can maintain the track and estimate the position and the velocity by the combination of the parameters derived from various sensors. And this is another application, similarly for an UAV of a combat class. It's for a targeting application where basically, in a targeting in a manned platform, in the mission plan, the waypoint of the target is programmed, and the track and the approach angle, everything is planned. Okay, and the pilot does two important functions over there. One is identifying the target, and another is minimizing the target location error. So these two processes, we needed to automate it, because being an UAV class of an aircraft, if these two processes need to be done by a ground pilot, it has its own bandwidth requirement and inherent delays. So how to go about this? The challenges involved in this is the designing a set of algorithms which has to detect, recognize and identify the target in various aspects and various background and in real time. That was the challenge over here. And basically going for a different level of autonomy from the detection to the identification level. What is the basic, in every level you should design a different feature sets for the target. And not only that, then the classification mechanism should be very efficient. So that's a challenge over here. And we have to minimize the target location error by geolocating the target so that the CEP, whatever need to be there, can be achieved. And the specification for this is the recognition range of about 5 to 10 kilometers. And the field of view has a it has a coarse field of view during the detection space and narrowed down the field of view for the other phases, like the recognition and identification. And we are aiming at the altitude of operation is about 5 kilometers. And the speed is about 0.75 to 0.8 Mach. And it's for the ground targets of different classes like military tanks, bridges, ground weapons, and it has to operate in adverse weather conditions. And another important program which we are looking into is the infrared search and track system. This system need to detect, locate and track the IR emitting objects basically. And this is a high sensitive, long range and wide field of regard sensor. That's a basic thing. And it also has to go till the identification phase. So the level of autonomy required is very high over here. And it will provide the 3D coordinates with a laser tracker. What is the challenge in such a system? So designing an IR optical receiver which has to provide both search and detection over a wide field of regard. The other important thing is the algorithm, which should have a high probability of detection and very low false alarm rate. It's a challenge what I talked before, the level of autonomy from the detection phase to the from the identification phase, the basic feature sets for class of aircrafts and the ground targets and the classification mechanisms. And today we are looking for it should have a large size of FPA with integrated cooling and readout electronics. And this is the specification of the system which we are looking for. The nose aspect of 30 to 50 kilometer, tail aspect of 80 to 100 kilometer, and a recognition range of 15 to 20 kilometers with a field of regard of plus or minus 90 degree and elevation minus 50 to 60 because for the aerial as well as for the ground targets with a laser ranger operating at 20 to 30 kilometers. And the type of targets are both airborne and the ground and that POS. The next system is the missile warning system. The missile warning system detects the missile threats by exploiting its plume signature in the mid-IR region of electromagnetic spectrum. Basically, the missile system has the various phases, the boost, mid-course, and the post-burnout terminal phase. And the detection should happen at the launch phase. Then only the declaration could be faster, and the reaction, what the pilot could take actions against it could be the faster thing. And this is one of the systems where we are looking for the detection probability close to 100%, and the false alarm rate better than 1 in 15 hours, the detection range about 5 kilometers for weakest manpad to 20 kilometers to the missile IR intensities. Then the field of regard, full spherical coverage with 6 sensors, and the angular resolution better than 5 milliradians, and the reaction time 1 to 2 seconds, and the closing speed and the type of missiles which we are dealing, and the altitude of operation is 10 kilometers approximately in the height. Okay. Now, these are the applications today we are dealing for the EO and IR concepts. The thing is, like, what are the system design considerations for these kind of an applications? So basically, the spectral characteristics of target and its background, atmospheric transmission, spectral response of the detector, and the hardware and the algorithm. Okay, now the spectral characteristics of the target. The target thermal signature need to be modeled. So once you understand the target thermal signature, you can work out for the efficient operating band. So the, if the operating band should be such a way that the signal to the clutter levels should be actually improved over there. And further, the signal to the clutter ratios can be improved by employing appropriate algorithms. Similarly, the signal to the noise levels should be efficient, or it should be improved. Such a detector need to be selected which has low noise equivalent intensity levels. And further, by the algorithms, these things can be improved. The spectral characteristics of the target. This is a very generalized concept which is given by the Planck's law, that the energy distribution for the object at various temperatures over a wavelength spectrum. That is what it actually shows. Then the Bean's law shows the peak wavelength of the radiation. So now, how much is the radiance from an object is nothing but the area. Suppose it is between 3 to 5 or something, then the area of the curve given below the spectral band gives the target radiance that is available at the receiver level. So, but this is very general thing because it's only a radiance concept. Now, the signal gets further attenuated by the atmospheric transmission. This is also a general curve where it's based on the wavelength. Okay, for a different wavelength band, here is the atmospheric window. So, suppose if you consider 7 to 14, it has a very good transmission characteristic. And here there's nothing, it's attenuated. Similarly, 3 to 5, you have a very good transmission characteristics. So when you design for a particular target, what is the atmospheric band which need to be there, these all factors needs to be considered. And the system bandwidth is centered around the peak wavelength of the target emission. Then comes the choice of the detector. According to the application, you select the particular spectral band. The spectral band, in that, what is the material that need to be chosen? Detector material that need to be chosen. So here, if it's an example for an indium antimonide at 80 degree Kelvin, there you can see that from 3 to 5, its performance is from 80 to 90 degree. So this material is very good for a spectral band of 3 to 5. So this is the choice which you make it. And the response time of the detector should be within microseconds. And the detectivity characteristics also should be very high. Cooling requirements needs to be considered. And basically then you have to define your field of view at the IFOV requirements and the FPA requirements. Then comes the hardware and the algorithms. So this class of applications where you deal with high level of computations, you should have a hardware which supports much of the parallel processing and very high computing power. That is the one thing. Now I am getting into the algorithm components for an ATR kind of a system basically. So these are the major blocks, in that you have an imaging sensor, and from here you get an image stream as an output, which is basically, it is a pre-processed one, it is a stabilized one, and it's an enhanced image. Then it goes into the clutter rejection. The detection to the concerned tracks, and from the and you get the tracks out of it, it goes for a feature extraction. So basically the problem is centered for any target, what is the feature set that is need to be defined. If you identify a proper feature set and a classifier for that, which gives the truth measurement of classifying it with the, where you get maximum probability of detection and low false alarm rate. Then the whatever is getting classified as a true target or a false, if it's a true declaration, it goes to a threat handler, and appropriate action will be taken by the system. Okay. The clutter rejection module. This is one of the important thing. It's in the detection phase, where you have to, the main aim of this module is to reduce the clutter levels. and get only the signal characteristics. The signal plus you will be having certain false targets plus the sensor noise. So the choice of the what algorithms you need to use in a clutter rejection phase is a choice of how much improvement you can get in the signal to clutter level and signal to noise levels. That is the choice of the algorithm you should have. It can be done in the spatial, or it can be done in the spatial or temporal method or spectral discrimination method. So once you decide on the algorithms, okay, then you get the clutter rejection done, then it's given for a thresholding where you try to reduce further the false alarms and the sensor noise. So for every frame, clutter rejection stage generates a certain number of detections. Yeah. I have taken, this is an example where I'm giving an example from an missile warning system and an IRST kind of a system. A point target. Basically, here we consider it the target to be a point target. So the the intensity is getting focused mainly on one detector element, and the detection happens to be as a single pixel detection. And you can have the point spread function defined for that, how it needs to be working out. That's a major thing. Then another is temporally correlated images. It's nothing but the frame rates or the sampling rate of the images are very high. So it's almost considered that the background is stationary. This is one of the major criteria which we have considered for the background estimation and elimination of the background to reduce the clutter level. This is another thing. Then the multispectral approach. The multispectral approach, we have taken a dual color approach where basically the operating band which you choose inherently should have the signal to clutter levels high. That is one of the major concerns. And if you take an example here for a missile plume, the intensity is high over 4 to 5 and relatively less in this band. And if you say the sun glint, the false targets, it's the other way. So now if one of the criteria could be a spectral discrimination, where you choose, it's basically on the contrast basis, where you see the missile plume, if you take the ratio of 4 to 5 to 3 to 5, its ratio will be very high compared to this one. So spectrally, you are actually able to eliminate the false alarms in this way. So multi-spectral approach is getting its importance due to these things. It's not basically sensitivity issue, it's a contrast concept. So in the background estimation process, you, by the temporal means, what we do is we eliminate the background by considering the previous frame to the current frame, which are very highly correlated in time. Okay. So the background is estimated in that way, and the previous to the current, you eliminate, you subtract them and eliminate the clutter, and whatever residual image you get, it apply the appropriate threshold so that still the false alarms and the sensor noise get reduced, and you are left with detections, which is both false alarms and the targets, true targets. And tracking and association phase, the next phases. This is very important phase because this is spatially every detection needs to be associated with its tracker. That's the thing. And you have to estimate the position and velocity of the target here. So the prediction, you have to have a good choice of the prediction filters according to the non-linear optimal filters, what you need to choose. It could be a Kalman, extended Kalman, and centered Kalman filter. Okay. So the output of this module is a set of track which are correlated over the time. And here you have to maintain the track, and you have to create new tracks, you have to delete the tracks, and you should face the problem of missing detections. Everything you have to take care. And this is the discrimination phase, where the track input, nav data, and image buffers are given as input to the feature extraction phase. The feature set definition is the core of the full system, which describes the specific attributes which you should be able to determine. So the feature extraction example for a missile warning system could be the intensity, its point target function, then it could be the image line of sight rate, azimuth rate. So you have to define what you can extract from the target information. So now the feature extraction estimates everything, then it gives to a classifier who actually in the classification you discriminate whether you have a weightage given to everything and you classify whether it's a true or a false target. Now, my paper was a technical, purely a technical paper where I have explained one of the features, how it can be extracted. That is basically a classification for a moving target feature. The problem. Given a set of detections which are associated as a track, we need to address that whether the track originated from a static target or a dynamic target. So these are the frames, okay, and these are the detections. Proposed framework is if a track belongs to a static target of detections, or then it will be observed to be moving along with the background. If it is otherwise, there will be deviations the way the target and the background moves. This is the deviation that need to be, in terms of distance, that need to be estimated here. So basically you classify whether the target in the track is a static or a dynamic one. The proposed, now you can see that it's a background track. The problem is background tracking. How do you track the background? Or you take this is a detection, you take a local background around it, and you have to track this background. Now, if it's a static target, then the movement is observed to be along with the background, from one frame to the another frame, next frame, over the time. If it's a dynamic target, the background and the target, there's a deviation in the movement. The problem is to identify the deviation, to classify it. So you have here a detection track and a background track. The background tracking approach, what we took is an optical flow method. The optical flow method is an image alignment problem. Basically, you take a template from an image and track the way the template can be aligned with the image over a period of time. So the same thing we have used here. Frame n minus 1 to frame n, how is the background movement is happening? So what is the transformation that could happen within that? So we have assumed here it to be an affine transformation between the frames. Affine transformation, basically it's a translation, rotation, scaling and shear movement. This one. So you derive the current position of the background from the previous position by applying the affine parameters. Okay. Initially, you give an initial estimate of the affine transformation by image registration process by the navigational data. Then, from the next frame onwards, between every frame this is happening. Okay. So now, after the initial estimate, from the third frame onwards, you need to basically, when it moves from here to, this is an estimate, basically. So the estimate, you have to model with an error function. It's basically an optimization problem where the error function is the intensity values between the background in the previous frame to the current frame. And the error function should have a minimum value. Okay. So you try to now refine your affine parameters till you get the minimum error values. Okay, in this method, the implementation consideration is the background have to be tracked without the target information, and you have to cater for the missing frames. It means that the detections need not be there available for every track. So you have to estimate the detection position if there is a missing detections, and the background will move out of the frame after a certain period of time. You have to get a new background, and that's the thing. And this algorithm works well if the background is totally a constant or a stationary one or a uniform one, then this algorithm has its own limitation. It requires certain contrast to track the things. So one of the features I took it and explained here. Now the current warfare scenarios, detecting the threats by a passive method is taking its own advantage compared to the radar because of your low observability in the nature. And IR radiation can detect the threats or interrupt passively during day and night operations are also possible. And in there, we have taken and most of the things, what we are looking today is the specification for all the systems. We have worked out on it. And another thing is we are concentrating more on the algorithms, the detection algorithms and the classifier and the feature set, these things. So this is where we are building up our strength today to attack all these problems. And I want to acknowledge my director here. It is all his ideas, and we are working towards this. And today I have a small strength of efficient scientists who are only working on these algorithms. So with this, I want to conclude my session.
Questions, please.
It's a once again. It's over after some certain frames. You decide after considering the how many frames you want to know. Between the affine transformation is being calculated, the parameters are getting optimized between frames. It's between two frames. You optimize the affine parameters. It's not over a time period. Between the two, first you calculate, you have an initial guess, calculate what could be the affine parameters. Then you go for an optimization thing where the error function should have a minimum value. Change the parameter value such that you get the minimum.
Charles, I think we can meet at there and discuss this. It's easier. Okay. Any other question? The basic concept of this paper itself is to throw open the work being done in this area. The concept of a common automatic target recognition applying to 3 or 4 applications is a unique one, and I am quite sure in this country there are a lot of players in these 3 or 4 different applications. This exposure is to see that people network and then share data with each other. Thank you.